Aloha, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to The Experience. I'm your host, Jeremy Vaney, and this week's show is kind of special in a way, in that I'm having an actual MUFON researcher on, if you can believe that. I know what you're thinking, Jer, but wait a minute, what? Oh yes, it's true. Ben Moss is with us. You can check him out at www.mufonva.com. He will also be on a show called Greatest Mysteries on the Travel Channel, talking about UFOs and the such. That'll be in November or December, so watch out for that. But right now, you can listen to him talk about Lonnie Zamora and the Socorro UFO, because that is the bulk of what we're going to talk about, at least in the first half. And then in the second half of the show, we're going to be a little more freeform than that. But I want to find out, how do we approach cold cases in research? How does one get new information? Is there new information? What is it? Right? Okay, good. So we will talk about that and oh so much more for non-subscribers after these messages. For subscribers, let's talk to Ben Moss right now.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So, what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years, New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome to the program Ben Moss. Ben, thank you for coming on the show and doing this.
Thanks for having me.
So I actually reached out to you, which, as listeners of this show know, I don't often do to researchers. I usually talk to experiencers because researchers, with exceptions, of course, seem to be firmly embedded in a belief system about what all of this ufological and paranormal stuff is. But you had said something on Facebook that caught my eye, that we'll get into in a little bit. But first, let's talk about how it is that you became a UFO researcher in the first place. And how long have you been researching UFOs?
Actual research over 20 years, a little bit on and off, but I got interested. I saw in 1966, and I'm dating myself, my dad was watching a Walter Cronkite special on UFOs, and it was a little bit of a debunking show, but I was fascinated and hooked from that point forward. So I think the kids in the neighborhood actually went out and threw a bunch of Frisbees in the air and took pictures of it to claim we had seen UFOs. So we were early hoaxers as kids.
Well, it's funny that I hadn't thought about this before, but yeah, if you're watching a special on TV or a news program that is, you know, winking and nudging or just outright trying to debunk something, adults might scoff at it, but kids might actually get interested because that's not the angle that's exciting for them. It's just the fact that this could exist. So they could actually be doing themselves a disservice in some sense.
Yeah, I mean, you know, kids are still more open-minded and don't have the all that code written to their brain yet, so they're open to things. And then you mimic things you see on TV. I did growing up, and that was just normal. We went out looking for them, and when we didn't see them, we threw Frisbees up and took pictures with our lousy cameras and try to convince people we saw a UFO.
And did you associate UFO with alien?
In the day, I read a lot of – my only exposure, because there was limited technology, was going to – I was a big comic book geek, and I'd go to the store to buy a comic book, and there'd be these UFO magazines. So that's how I started hearing about cases from other places, other countries. And then I went to the library and parked out in the library and read all of Dinsky's books and all kinds of UFO books on the subject. And that's what really got me. The more I read, the more I wanted to find and absorb and look into it, even at a young age.
And so ultimately now, at least for what, the past few years, you've sort of landed on the Socorro case from 1964, right? So this is considered to be sort of the one really well-documented blue book case that is unexplainable and has a sort of unimpeachable witness to it. Is that why you keep going back to this case?
Well, it's an interesting story. What happened was I had gone to the 2014 MUFON symposium with Tony Angiola, who researches with me. He's with MUFON in Virginia. And we were listening to James Fox, and he was talking about his then-titled movie 701, which should be out in a couple of months under a different name. But he had a piece about Socorro, and I thought, and it triggered my memory. I said, well, I bet he shows this clip that I saw on the TV show back in the day. And he didn't show it, and I got a hold of him afterwards and asked him if he'd heard about it. And I remembered seeing this show on Sightings, where this family had run into police officer that took them down to the site, and sure enough, she had footage of the Socorro site not long after the incident. And so to make a long story short, I told James I'd find the footage. I found the footage, and then I wrote an article about that because it was long. I had to go around the world to find out it was in my own backyard, basically. And then Jan Harzon, who heads MUFON, got a call from Ray Stanford, the original investigator from 1964, who Hynek invited down to the site and who investigated and wrote Socorro Saucer in a Pentagon Pantry. So he hooked us up, and we passed Ray's background checks to visit him at his house. And got to know him really well, and then got, you know, read his book and got really involved in Socorro to the point where we knew there was still more to the story. And we found more things, and some of it's going to be in James Fox's movie that he found. But every time you dig into the case, it gets more interesting and has more data behind it.
Well, that is interesting. So how does that happen? Because, you know, police do these cold cases all the time, or they just have them sort of sitting around, that for years and years, they can't come up with anything new. I guess if you're not a cop, you wouldn't know how it differs. But how, if you know, does it differ in ufology where you can come up with new evidence?
Look, you know, I've done a lot of investigations. I'm the chief field investigator in Virginia, but, you know, you can apply later technology to older evidence and get more data out of it. So with this case, there's still the rock that Ray has that may have some evidence left in it. We're still trying to get some kind of analysis for it. Still the fact that, and he hates me talking about it, but there is a photograph that he took 120 days after the incident that do show several craft in the air that are egg-shaped, and that's never been published, and we're trying to get him to release that, but he can't find the negative, so he doesn't want to release it because, you know, he feels that people will attack him, which they will, but without the negative. But so I've seen the photo. I know there's a picture of the craft as described by Lonnie, and then when we were there, I was on site two different times. There were witnesses we found that never talked to the press, but told people. There was a woman sitting on her porch that said that the thing came down the river. She saw it, and it was egg-shaped with a blue flame under it coming down the river, and then took a turn. And when we found that part of the river, the turn would take it right towards where the witness that went to Opal's Grinders gas station and said it almost hit their car, and then followed to the gully where Lonnie saw it. All matched up. So that was a piece that had never come out in public. And then we talked at length to Ray, one of Lonnie Zamora's good friends. And he told us things that, haven't really been out in the public. And And so there's a lot of – and there's more evidence of egg-shaped craft, at least 9 other cases that I found going through all the papers, newspapers of the time. And so up and down 60 West area, there were multiple cases of this type of craft, which supports Lonnie's story. In and of itself, it has a lot of evidence. But when you look into this case and realize there was a landing at White Sands, there was a landing at Hollerman, the military saw it, they had it on radar, a pilot saw it with a symbol on the side, then you have a lot more data that shows these things were flying around in that area in this time frame for at least a year.
And, of course, I'm being a bad host because I'm just assuming everyone knows what the case is, but maybe they don't. So maybe if you could just give just a rough sketch of what we're actually talking about.
Sure. On April 24th of 1964, Lonnie Zamora was on random patrol in Socorro, New Mexico, and saw somebody speeding, went after him. And as he was coming next to what's the desert in Socorro, but as he was chasing a speeder, a blue flame went over his car from left to right. And he didn't know what it was, but he was thinking, you know, airplane in distress or something. So he breaks off from the speeder, goes up this hill, sees what he thinks is an overturned car with a couple of teenagers next to it. But upon a little bit closer examination, he estimated that the two things in white coveralls standing next to this object on the ground were only about 4 feet tall. So anyway, as he gets closer, he notices it's actually an egg-shaped object on 4 landing gear. And then it he gets close enough to it to within about 35 feet, according to Ray Stanford, and sees a symbol on the side, and then there's a loud roar. He hits the ground. His army training, you know, trained him to hit the ground with his head away from the object, and then it rose up in the air with a blue knifing flame that wasn't a propellant-type flame, seemed to be some type of exotic propulsion, almost like an iron engine would look with the blue flame and orange tips. So it lifts up, and then it goes silent. This engine cuts off, and apparently another engine kicks in, and there's a winding down sound, and then it starts going towards the dynamite shack and what's called the perlite mill in the direction of the southwest, and then picks up speed and apparently goes supersonic all the time, not making a noise. So it was witnessed by a police officer. Another police officer, Sergeant Chavez, showed up pretty quickly and said that Lonnie was just freaked out, and he was basically freaked out for the rest of his life from this incident. And so it's one of those cases. I think it's one of the top 10 cases in the USA. It has more evidence, close encounter of the third kind. There was metal at the site. There was indentations. There was scorched earth. And the Blue Book investigation still has it classified as an unknown. They never figured out what it was, and it was probably the one case that sent Hynek over the edge. Dr. Hynek with Project Blue Book sent him over the edge, where he just stopped debunking UFOs and formed CUFOS, Center for UFO Studies, and started actually studying these things.
Is that metal still around to be examined?
Well, the metal was taken to Goddard, and Goddard, Dr. Frankel, this is all in Ray's book, but there's other things that, you know, hadn't been known about this case. Dr. Frankel analyzed it and told Ray that if there was something weird, he'd write a paper and come back to him. But, of course, we now know something is strange about metal. You turn in, they'll classify it, and you'll never hear about it again. That's kind of what happened. They came back and said, when at first he said it was iron and I think magnesium, but or iron and aluminum. And that's not unusual. It's just the way it was combined was not conforming to any metallurgic chart in here in Russia or anything that was on record. And so there's something strange about it. But then when Frankel was, nobody could reach him anymore, and somebody else stepped in and said, hey, we're going to give you the rock back. We're sorry. It was just silicate. And for anybody to say you could confuse metal with silicate, which is sand, is just ludicrous. And so they took the metal. They were only supposed to use half of it. They took all of it. Ray got the rock back with no metal in it. But the initial test showed it to be an unusual isotope range in the way it was combined. So, and it's interesting because the metal had been in a bag for a long time. It was this bright, shiny metal. And when they analyzed it in this report, in this letter that's on the internet that we found, it says that the thing hadn't corroded at all. So obviously it had some kind of properties. It was painted on the outside of a strut or something. It was anti-corrosive and didn't seem to be affected by any type of weathering.
Not too long ago, Jacques Vallée at a UFO conference talked about some slag that came off of a UFO that had odd isotopic ratios. Do you know how that compares?
That case is, there's a couple of cases with slag, but usually upon analysis, it's just slag, which is, you know, the remnants of it can be the forge or all. There's lots of things that cause slag, but basically the one case is where they had some of the metal fragments were taken on an airplane and the plane blew up, which is always, you know, you can think whatever you want about things like that. Could have just been coincidence. But in all the cases, and this is why I kind of draw a line about saying, you know, we're being visited by aliens or anything, is I just don't see any proof. I think that could be one of the reasons, but I don't see any proof. And all the metal fragments we have, as interesting as they are, I still haven't seen anything that's that unusual, except for possibly what was supposedly from the Roswell crash. I'm not saying the Roswell crash happened, but you know that magnesium with the bismuth layers, just really strange, and nobody could figure out who had manufactured it. It was obviously manufactured, but had all kinds of interesting properties. I think it blocked cosmic rays, and if you put electricity through it, it would lift. So when they analyzed it, I think at Sandia Lab, they said it, you know, would be excellent for a lifting body, but they weren't told what it was. So, but you know, it's just until you have DNA or a piece of a, you know, of a craft, I just don't think you can say what the phenomena is. And that's probably why I don't ever think there'll be disclosure, because they can't come out and say, hey, don't worry about it. We don't know what the hell's going on. But
well, that's what you sort of what you wrote on Facebook was, after however many years of studying this, you walk away not believing that it is necessarily aliens. And I thought, well, that's interesting, especially since you're focused now on a case that is generally considered really good evidence for aliens. I mean, you've got a craft. It's doing crafty things. It's doing like technological things. There are beings associated with it. So, you know, the mind wants to leap to people just like us from somewhere else, but you're not going that way. I find that commendable, actually.
Well, yeah, I mean, just because it, you know, I think it was something non-human, but just because it's not human doesn't mean it's ET. It could be, you know, the world's a place, and that's probably one of the reasons why I'm so interested in the field, is because you get some really bizarre data that sounds so off the normal path that I don't think anybody even made it up, because it's just so strange sometimes. The phenomenon generates different things. And I, you know, if it's, it could be some intelligence that's been here a lot longer than us and have the same space and is just not human. It could be interdimensional or poor, you know, if string theory is still in vogue, that postulates multiple dimensions. And I just couldn't say that something got in a spaceship and drove here from another planet. There's no evidence of that. That could be happening, but I still don't see any evidence of that. So when people talk about reptilians and grays and things like that, I'm like, huh, you know, show me the data.
Well, and here's a question. Do you believe the setup of this case? I mean, do you believe that it is possible that highly advanced whatever's from wherever could just be startled by this cop coming up on them, and they had no idea that this was going to happen, and it was all just a huge Keystone Cops moment?
We'll be back after this.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't. when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Ann Streber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there, as well as a pre-order link for New. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
The interesting thing about Socorro is that, you know, the government looked, and I have all the documents asking all the black projects and Bells and Hughes and all these laboratories. And this was the Joint Chiefs and the CIA and FBI asking the questions. So they all had to answer. But it wasn't made here. Nobody could say, and there's still not a craft that has those kind of properties. But, you know, it sounded like from all the evidence we have, that thing was in trouble. It was definitely having problems. There's two instances, and this isn't really public, but I'll just bring it up. We ran across a story, and somebody else who's investigating it ran across a story that something was picked up off the ground from the craft after it left. And I also heard that the creatures were actually looking up under the craft like there was something going on. They had to land. If you've been to the site, the interesting thing about this Aurora, there's a bowl-like depression. Of all the places it could have landed, that's the perfect place to land, that if you're about 40 yards away, you have this ridge line that you can't see over. But it's a good distance away. So if you weren't in that area and it's off the beaten path, then that was a good place to land to check out the craft and see what was going on. I mean, it sounds like a mechanical device with creatures. It's just that, you know, they don't sound human, but I have no idea where they came from or what they are.
So are you open to the possibility that there's sort of a trickstery phenomena that is perhaps trying to get us to believe that it's alien, or whatever our sort of just in the distant future sense of where we're going is?
Well, as my friend Chris O'Brien will say, there's definitely a lot of researchers will say this. There's a lot of trickster in this whole phenomena. There's this, Freud would say it's, well, I'm not sure what Freud would say, but it's kind of a, it seems to manipulate time and space, and also the way you can perceive it and the way you can think about it. I think that a lot of the evidence shows that most of these things know when you're observing them. They seem to, you know, be able to change shape and do all kinds of strange things. So it just seems like if you're able to survive your own atomic age and killing each other and travel space and be able to overcome the speed of light and come from another place, then, you know, if you're 500 years ahead of us, that's going to look like one thing. But if something came here that was 500,000 years or 5 million years ahead of us, then you wouldn't understand it at all. And they could make it look like whatever they wanted it to look like. It could look like Sasquatch for, you know, all we know. So it's just like what we would do if we examine animals in the wild. We put fake animals out there with cameras in them, and we do all kinds of things to get good data and footage. Could be the same thing.
Hmm. Do you know who the last person to interview Lonnie Zamora was, or when, roughly?
There were several. He didn't talk a whole lot. Towards the end of his life, he kind of opened up a little bit, but I think the last person to talk to him probably was one of his relatives, but I don't know who interviewed him I know Greg Bishop just missed him, and I wish that I'd been able to interview him, but I don't know who the last person I talked to him was.
Hmm. Yeah, because I found it interesting that, so if people don't know, he died, I think it was in 2009. But he's a cop, and it seems to be, at least, not at all interested in investigating this, and in fact was sick of the attention, sick of being interviewed by the Air Force, sick of being interviewed by UFO investigators in the media. And according to Wikipedia, he became a gas station attendant just to sort of have some anonymity in his life. That's interesting to me because a lot of people, especially in sort of ghost hunting outfits, are former cops. And a lot of people in ufology are former cops, and they seem to be really interested in this stuff. And I wonder, is there something about having such an up-close and personal encounter where you're like, you know what? I'm good. I don't need to look into this anymore. Or did he have other experiences? Has he ever alluded to that, having had other experiences before and after this?
Oh, here's the thing about Lonnie. I've talked to his daughter, and his wife spoke recently to James Fox, and there's a lot of interviews you can see on there. But I talked to a lot of his friends also. The thing about Lonnie was he was a devout Catholic, and he thought he had seen demons because when he got – apparently, I think he got a little bit closer than what he told people, or he got a better look at what these things look like when he made it this amorphous things in white coveralls. I think he got more detail. And when Ray Hynek were there and he said, how tall were they? And he held his hand about 4 feet up a creosote bush. Here's what I think happened. As a devout Catholic, he got really close and realized that he was thinking he was walking up on some kids, and it was these creatures that weren't human, and they were startled. One of them turned and was startled to see him. And at that moment, he realized that they certainly weren't human, and his mind jumped to the first thing he could think was they're demons. And so that night, after all the grilling interviews from the FBI and Captain Holder and everybody there, he went to his priest and spent 3 hours talking to him about the incident. And his priest ended up telling him, because he thought he'd seen a demon, his priest kept trying to calm him down. And he said, look, Lonnie, you can do one of two things. You can not talk about it ever again, or you can just tell the truth. And Lonnie's story never really changed over the years. He kept saying the same thing over and over. He had plenty of opportunities to, to stop talking about it or just say, I made it up. And the government had plenty of opportunities to come out and say, oh, we found it was a black project. We can't tell you about it. They never did that. And that's what's so fascinating about this case. You have a guy that was never the same. He worked in a gas station, and I think he drove a dump truck for a while, but he got tired of being in the public, and he said he wished he would never have reported it if he had it all over to do again. But towards the end of his life, he would say those creatures. And he wouldn't say that at first because the government, military, and Blue Book told him not to talk about the creatures anymore. And that's why in the files, there's not that much evidence about the creatures. And some of the files don't even mention the creatures because they told him to stop talking about it. But when you dig into it and see all the inside, because we got the Blue Book files that Tom Mercer got on Craigslist from a Blue Book person whose father had just had them in a box. And the internal documents are real interesting because it shows how baffled they were about the case and how they couldn't explain it. And the evidence just added up to an unusual incident.
So Craigslist is the new FOIA request. That's excellent.
Yeah, it's funny. It was Blue Book files online, and Mr. Mercer was in MUFON, Ohio, and he got these files. He called the gentleman up, and his father was in Blue Book, and the files are genuine. And we got them. It has a lot of detail about the symbol and the investigations and the handwritten notes. Actually, he sent me the photograph that they show a lot of the police car on top of the hill where the site is down below. I have the original Blue Book photograph with writing on the back of it. But these were files that didn't make it into Blue Book, but were part of the Socorro Blue Book file, which is interesting. That tells you that Blue Book files aren't complete. They yank some things out of there.
Hmm. Yeah. What do you think it is about talking about creatures that is taboo when the whole thing implies that there must be a driver, at least?
Well, I think a lot of these things could be, not piloted, could be just like the drones we send. But with that, I think that the story was so unusual, they could get, you know, kind of get a control over it without him mentioning creatures. You know, you have enough with a UFO landing in the desert seen by a police officer. The fact that what's interesting about the case is the news got out really fast before anybody could put a clamp on it. So by the time even the Blue Book guys got there who live close by, this thing was well known all over town and people were talking about it and the newspaper picked it up and they were there that night and the next morning taking pictures, and it was a shot heard around the world.
Well, it's interesting. Would they have had unmanned craft in 1964?
We had vertical takeoff vehicles.
Vertical takeoff vehicles, but that people knew about? Because it seems like either way it would be kind of shocking. Like if you were to tell the public there was nothing piloting this thing, that would be shocking. And if you told them, well, I saw people in jumpsuits, that actually sounds a little less hard to take, because then that could be humans.
Yeah, it's like a lot of people accepted, even though it was shown not to be true, that it was the lunar lander with two technicians. And the lunar lander at that time frame wasn't even flying. It was being dropped from a helicopter to test the integrity of its strength. And that engine used a solution called hydroxine. So they had to rebuild the engine every time they fired it off because it would burn up. And, you know, the lander was meant to operate in almost no atmosphere whatsoever. So the lander wasn't anywhere near it. And the internal files, that a lot of them came from Craigslist, show that they asked everybody and nobody could answer it. And then when the government asked Hynek, can we, you know, blow this off as hallucination? He says, look, an hallucination doesn't put four holes in the ground and burn a creosote bush in half. That's another thing. That flame burned a bush that's a resinous bush that takes an incredible amount of heat to even make it smolder. And the fact that it just played over this bush for, you know, maybe a second or two and sliced it almost perfectly in half just tells you that a lot of, you know, radiation or heat coming out of the bottom of that thing.
Now, I forget this, and so please let me know if I'm completely wrong, but that the insignia on this craft, was that the same insignia? Was this the case where, like, years earlier some UFO cult had that insignia?
No, there was a UMO case.
Yeah, which that's what I'm thinking
was,
of.
Was a hoax.
Right, a hoax case.
Yeah,
okay.
I think that was a hoax. The symbol, I disagree with Kevin Randall and his conclusion on this, and I kind of side with Ray, but the symbol, you know, was drawn by Lonnie, but not the drawing. The drawing that he signed, you can tell it's two different handwriting. Somebody drew the symbol and Lonnie signed it. And that happened when Holder was sitting there and the FBI agent Burns was there. And, of course, the FBI said, don't tell anybody we were here. And that didn't cover up very well. But they created that umbrella with the arrow pointing up. And that's the one that Lonnie signed and became public knowledge. But when I was looking at all the newspaper reports for the first 3 or 4 days after the incident, they were all the inverted V with three bars. And so the interesting thing about that is that Holder's son, and Holder had passed away, but Lieutenant Holder's son, who was the Blue Book guy on site, he told Ray and sent Ray Stanford a letter that said, my father told me that he had Lonnie sign an obscured symbol because that way they could tell if somebody gave the true symbol, which was the inverted V with three bars, they know they weren't making it up. If they gave the symbol they made up, then they were perpetrating a hoax. And so years later in 2005, I think when James Fox and Ray Stanford went to the National Archives to look at the Hynek files from Blue Book, they weren't going to let them in, but they showed that the famous picture that CIA keeps putting out of Lonnie Zamora standing there at the Socorro site, it's Ray Stanford standing next to him. They keep using that photo, and they proved that this was Ray, you know, looking at this file. They found Hynek's file that it was a top secret file. But it shows the symbol drawn by Hynek at the time, and it was an inverted V with a bar at the top, a bar in the middle, and a bar at the bottom. And so that's what we think the symbol was. And there's an alchemy symbol like it. There's some things like it. I think it might be a symbol for radiation. I kind of threw that out to Ray because the V was pointing right to where the blue flame came out. So I thought maybe this means don't stand here. You'll get cooked. Right. As somebody else pointed out, it could mean eat at Joe's in alien language, so you just don't know.
Ladies and gentlemen, that jingle means our time is up. I want to thank Ben Moss for coming on the show and teaching us about Socorro and beyond. And check out his work at MUFONVA.com. Of course, if you're a non-subscriber, you missed like half of this show. So click the subscribe tab and get the full episode commercial-free, all episodes commercial-free, of course, and Dreamland as well. And everything else Whitley has on tap here at unknowncountry.com. Thank you all for listening. I will see you next week.